Hey everyone, Happy New Year! Hope everyone's doing well. I just wanted to say thank you for this past year of all the support and friendships and everything going on through the channel. Really appreciate that. And I don't have a whole lot of time to play for fun anymore because of my school psych job. But yeah, it's gotten really busy. But I wanted to just at least say hi. And I haven't done a video like this in a long time. Sorry for kind of shaky camera. I'm holding it in my hand for a minute here. Because one of my friends, Lindsay, we were kind of having a discussion about bass drum technique and heel down versus heel up technique. So I wanted to do just kind of a quick video, I guess instructional video, in addition to saying hi to people and wishing everyone a good 2024. And be safe out there tonight. You know how New Year's can get. But yeah, anyway, thank you guys so much for all the support, all the continued friendships, and everything going on through the channel, even though I've been kind of absent this year. Well, for a while now, not just this year, but it's been for a while. But this year's gotten a lot busier, so I don't have as much time to play for fun and just kind of practice my own stuff and play my own stuff much anymore. Still jamming on the weekends with friends and that kind of stuff, but yeah, just been busy. But God bless. Hope everyone's safe. Happy New Year. And we'll see what 2024 brings us, right? Okay, so let's get to some bass drum technique stuff here. And yeah, the post is gonna be kinda in the way, but that's how it is. You can still see my foot and my action. So, just quickly, kinda covering the bases as far as playing 16ths with one bass drum pedal, or even 30 seconds faster figures, just depending on what you're playing, what your tempo is. But when you're playing heel down, you're basically using all of this shin muscle right here. And once you start to get to faster technique and faster tempos, it really will start to kind of hold you back in addition to really burning out that shin muscle. So your shin muscle will get very tired pretty quickly. Versus when you're playing heel up, you're using more of a hinge motion from your hip, and you're using your whole leg and kind of this loose motion in your heel. You can think of it like when you're doing a double stroke, when you're using wrist and finger technique. I'm gonna get my hand a little lower, but wrist and finger technique. And if you didn't have this kind of, you know, fluid motion with your wrist, it'd be a lot harder, right? If you just had kind of a static grip, or you had to like just do all fingers or hinge from this way, rather than being able to kind of free flow and move all your hinge groups and you let your wrist and your fingers work in conjunction with one another. Same kind of idea on the bass drum. So when you're like this, like let's say we're just playing like a 1 inch, a 3 inch, a 1 inch, that kind of thing. 1 inch, a 3 inch, a 1 inch, a 3 inch. So once you guys start to get to faster tempos, this will really start to burn. Right? You can still get quite a bit out of it, but once you lift your heel up, and this is different from slide technique, you don't have to slide your heel. That's another technique where you're doing, and it's kind of hard to see, but you'll see my heel is hinging back and forth while my ball of my foot stays on the pedal. That kind of a thing. Versus just keeping your legs nice and relaxed. And what I say is I teach my students to be a little bit penguin-toed. So instead of pigeon-toed, you know, your feet are in like this. Have them the opposite way, where your heels are out or inward a little bit. So that way you have all this range of motion over here and your heel won't hit the heel plate. If your foot's straight onto the pedal, you have a little bit less range of motion because your heel will hit the heel plate. But if you move your heel out here a little bit, now you've got all this range of motion, all that range of motion. And then you're able to use the combination of your weight of your leg, playing for more of the hip, gravity, and your hinge group. So it's kind of like having that fluid loosey-goosey motion so that you can flow easily and kind of move easily, and same thing with your hands. Same thing with your foot. So each kind of figure has its own technique depending on what you're playing on the bass drum and with 16ths. But the main part of it is toe ball. So not toe heel, but toe ball. And once you get used to it, you can see how little motion I'm doing. And I'm not sliding my foot back and forth. I'm just using two motions in one leg raise. So when your leg comes up, that's the first strike. When you drop your leg, that's the second strike. So you can get that motion going really quick. That kind of a thing. I may not play the snare so much. But it's really important to kind of work on that technique, because when you're playing heel down, not only you can't get as much power, but also, like I said in the beginning, it's all shin muscle. You're playing all from that shin, and it will burn out over a while. Like, imagine if you tried to flutter with constant 16ths versus more of that twitch motion, like, you know, when you're bored in class or something, you're sitting at your desk and you're just twitching your leg on the ground. It's kind of that motion. And then you can play straight 16ths, triplets, and play light, and then play heavier. So once you kind of get used to it, I promise it's a relaxed motion. It allows you to use your hinge groups in addition to using the weight of your leg. So for instance, like a dotted eighth tied to a 16th. Now I'm playing one, a two. Now that motion, I'm doing, so it's like that slow note in the beginning, and then the toe ball. So once you get used to that, I promise it's really relaxed and really easy to do without having to slide your foot back and forth. Now once you get going faster and that kind of thing, you're playing double bass drum pedal, yeah, slide technique can work really well, so that way you're getting, you know, a strike on each movement. But at first, just play it nice and relaxed with heel up. And keep your heel low to the ground, though. I'm not saying to start up here, that kind of thing. You want to start with your heel low, so then that way the any motion you put into your leg or into your hinge group goes straight into the beater. So once you start here, home position, back to home position. So you can use like a combination of fluttering, toe ball, toe, heel, ball. That's another way you can play faster figures, is toe, heel, ball. So there's lots of different ways you can kind of go about it, but that heel up, that's so important. That's so important to be able to play it, especially with faster figures. So that's another thing, is we call them practicing in groupings. Practice that in groupings. It's such a good exercise to do that. You can make it syncopated or stacked. Obviously, I'm making it stacked. I'm playing 16ths up here of. Or you can make it syncopated with eighths. Practice that in groupings. A good exercise for that is just a grouping of one. Well, it's just one note, but it's not a grouping. But then a grouping of two, grouping of three, grouping of four. That's a fantastic little warm-up exercise. I used to do that all the time, where I just start with either eighths or sixteenths and then flip it so that one way I'm playing it stacked, one way I'm playing it syncopated. So, you know, obviously beat one is going to be stacked if you're playing, you know, any figures that are involving quarter notes, eighths, or sixteenths. But once you're playing one, just start with, I'll do everything with 16ths at first. So 1E and a 2E and a 3E and a 4E and a 1E and a 2E and a 3E and a 4E. 1E, 3E, a 3N, 3N, 1E and a 3E and a. So you can play lots of different groupings that way, or do like four bars of each. 1, 3, one, That's a great exercise to just kind of get that foot warmed up, practicing some 16s, practicing them stacked, practicing them syncopated. But I promise you, like, once you start to get your foot really gone, if you're playing that all heel down, you're going to get tired quicker. It's going to burn that muscle out. And then once you start to play faster figures, it's quite difficult. But if you start to incorporate heel up, playing with your toe, so it's basically like pushing on your big toe, kind of like those first two digits here, your big toe and your middle toe, and then once you press on that, then just drop your foot. But you can see how it's really, it's a relaxed motion. I'm not sliding my heel back and forth. It's more of like a tap dancing kind of move versus playing slide technique. That's a lot of motion. That's lateral motion in addition to vertical motion, so it's kind of a lot of motion. But if you just keep, you know, nice and relaxed, keep the weight of your leg, use your knee as kind of a hinge grip, use the weight of your leg, let your heel be relaxed, and then also remember kind of a little penguin toed, man, it's a very, very useful and reliable technique once you kind of program it into your hands. It's the same thing as having, you know, rebounds and kind of that way you're using wrist and fingers, or even like triplets, or triple stroke, I should say. That kind of thing. Same idea with your feet. So yeah, it's really going to be helpful for you to kind of practice that way, Lindsay, I promise, especially as you get into faster figures, or then you start to get into four-way independence. So, and I'll try to move this back a little bit so you can see my left foot and how relaxed I'm playing with my left foot in addition to my bass drum. So I use kind of the same motion with both my feet. And the reason I moved the camera forward at first, because now this foot's going to be in the way. But just that way you can see just how relaxed I am when I'm using the weight of my leg and playing on the ball of my foot. And it's just that hinge motion. That's really all it is. And it's really nice and relaxed. So that's why I'm just, you know, playing nice and relaxed. So you can play quarter notes, you can play eighth notes, just like. Over here in your right hand, in your right hand or your right hand, whatever is your dominant hand, you just mash that with your foot. This leg out of the way so you can see it, but you can see how just relaxed it really is. Now, not saying that you can't play with your foot straight onto the pedal, and as long as you kind of got that motion figured out without hitting the heel plate, but yeah, if you come penguin toed a little bit, you have way more area to work with and more range of motion, which really helps with those faster figures and gives you way more power as you're doing it, especially on acoustic kits. Now, if you're playing on an electric kit and you have a trigger, then yeah, I mean, you don't have to put hardly any motion into it because the trigger is making the sound for you. But when you're working with an actual drum head, and rebound and gravity, you know, all those different, and you have to have more power, less power, be able to feather, be able to get, you know, louder figures out and different groupings out. There's really kind of that toe ball technique is really going to help you and be useful. So, like, just two figures really quick and I'll end it. I know I'm talking a lot, but at the same time, I want to make sure it's comprehensive so you can understand what I'm trying to explain. It's hard to explain through text, but showing it and then describing it is kind of the way to go. So, three figures that are great to practice besides that grouping exercise is a dotted eighth tied to a 16th. One, three, one, two, three, four, one, two, three, four. That's a good one to practice. It's more relaxed. Then another one is an eighth tied to 2/16ths. One and a. So that's where you're kind of doing that raise, first strike, and then toe ball, back to home position. Or you can do it down here and then toe ball. There's kind of different, you know, different ways of figuring it out. But whatever's the most comfortable for you and the most relaxed for you. And then the last one is that a three and a reverse of an eighth tied to 2/16ths, 2/16ths tied to an eighth. So you could do like one and, three and, or a one and, a three and. So those three are really good to practice, especially for syncopation. One, a two, three, a four. One and a two, three and. To get into like adding the E's in there, you know, start to subdivide or kind of grid with it. There's lots of different great things you can do with it. And then also practicing some linear fills with it is really important too. So not just within the groove sense, but practice them with your hands and your feet. So that way you can tie, your brain will then start to tie your hands and your feet together, which is really important for coordination exercises. So a really good one just to practice, right, left, kick, kick. And those are 16ths. So you're just playing one E and a, two and a. You can just get it up to whatever tempo you like, but that's a really good one to practice. Right, left, kick, kick. Okay, and then another one is just right, kick, kick. Triplets. One and a, two. Another really good one to practice. And then another one for other triplets, bottom triplets, either right left kick or left right kick. And you can speed that up too to whatever you want. But that'll kind of start to tie your hands and your feet together with coordination exercises. So you have those two different exercises you can practice in a groove sense, the one with groupings, one, two, three, four. You can have fun kind of interchanging them, creating combo patterns with them after you get warmed up with it. And then those three figures of a dotted eighth tied to a 16th, an eighth tied to 2/16ths, and the reverse, 2/16ths tied to an eighth. Those are really important figures to practice, and each one kind of has its own technique, or its own motion, I should say. It's still all heel-up technique, but you have different motions with each one. And again, look how much range you have to go. You can get a lot of notes out of one leg raise. Or just keep your heel there and do that rocking, that feathering motion. And you get way more power, as you can see, versus. And then if you do that for like 5 minutes, your shin is going to be burning, really burning. And you can only play kind of a lighter figure. But if you just get that heel up a little bit, look, you can get that twitch going, really relax, and just move that ankle. Okay? So hopefully that helps a little bit there, Lindsay, and everyone else, if you're looking at the bass drum technique stuff. I know it's kind of a DIY video here with just holding it, my phone in my hand with my USB mic on, but I want to at least show, you know, some different examples of what I mean, because it's hard to describe in text. So I want to post this video. Hopefully that helps. If you have any questions, please ask. I can always cover very specific figures if you have questions on those. But those exercises will really help. And I promise, once you start playing at faster tempos, once you start playing faster figures, if you're using one bass drum pedal for 16ths and 30 seconds, you know, it's really going to be crucial as you start to kind of develop that technique to be able to play that way, because you're going to get a lot less tired. You're going to be using multiple groups and the weight of your leg and gravity rather than trying to hinge all that on your shin muscle and playing heel down. So there's technical reasons for it, I guess, is what I'm trying to explain. So anyway, all right, guys. Love you. Happy New Year. Happy drumming. I hope everyone's doing well. And be safe out there, okay? Love you. Take care. Bye.